In this video, we'll learn how to test hypotheses in social network analysis. There are many ways to test a hypothesis. Here, I specifically introduce QAP correlation and QAP regression. QAP means quadratic assignment procedure. It is a non-parametric statistical test to determine the correlation between two networks. QAP correlation is a technique designed to correlate whole matrices using simulations to determine statistical significance. QAP regression is a technique that allows you to model the values of a dyadic dependent variable using one or more dyadic independent variables. If you have multiple independent variables, then you use multiple regression QAP, that is MR-QAP. Before I discuss the details of those techniques, I'd like to emphasize something in common in quantitative analysis. It is very important that you don't crunch numbers mindlessly. Your hypothesis testing must be guided by theories. This principle applies to the scientific process in all disciplines. Theories come first. Theories guide hypothesis development. What are the purpose of hypothesis testing? It is to further develop theories. If the results of your hypothesis testing support your hypothesis, then your study provides further evidence to support the theory you used to develop your hypothesis. If the results of your hypothesis testing does not support or only support partially your hypothesis, then things get more interesting. You can then explore how you can refine the existing theories. You can also examine whether the underlying assumptions of the existing theories are valid or not. This is how you refine existing theories and propose new theories by using empirical research. This is how you use your study to advance the theory development in your scientific field. Why don't we use standard inferential statistical test to analyze network data? This is because network data, by the nature of networks, violate three assumptions of standard inferential tests. First, standard inferential tests assume the observations are statistically independent, but network data are interdependent. If one node is removed from the network, it can influence all other nodes' connectivity in the network. Second, standard inferential tests assume the variables follow a particular distribution, such as a normal distribution. But the distribution of variables in networks does not follow a normal distribution. Instead, it may follow a power law distribution, like the degree distribution in scale-free networks. In network data, the distribution of variables may also be unknown. Third, the network data are probably not random. The ties are usually not developed in a random manner, particularly in social networks. But in standard inferential tests, you can assume that the data are a random sample. With those differences of network data, we need some special methods to analyze network data statistically. One way is QAP correlation. This is a network data set about the social relationships among Renaissance Florentine families. The data were collected by John Paget using historical documents. In the matrix, the rows and columns represent Florentine families during the Renaissance. This is a matrix that display marriage ties. One means a marriage relationship between two families. We have another matrix that displays business ties. One means a business relationship between two families. In this data set, the business relationship is defined as financial ties, such as loans, credits, and joint partnership. If those financial relationship existed between two families, we use 1 to indicate it. If you compare the two matrices, you can see the differences. The cell I point out means the two families had a marriage tie, but not a financial tie. To do comparisons, it is very important to make sure the sequence of the rows and columns in the two matrices are in the exact same order. I use the arrows to point out the two families that had no marriage ties but had financial ties. But this is just a visual examination. You read some literature and find out there is an assumption that economic transactions are embedded in social relationships. That means we can assume that there is a correlation between the network of marriage ties and the network of business ties among the Florentine families. To test whether this assumption is valid or not, we can use QAP correlation. QAP stands for Quadratic Assignment Procedure. What QAP does is to correlate the two matrices and calculate an ordinary measure of statistical association, such as Pearson's R. This is called the observed correlation. Does the observed correlation take place by chance alone? What are the chances of observing such a correlation even when the values of variables are assigned independently of each other? In other words, what are the chances of observing a correlation between the network of marriage ties and the network of financial ties among the Florentine families, even when we assign cell values that are independent of each other? How to assign cell values that are independent of each other? We take one of the matrices and randomly rearrange its rows and matching columns to create another pair of matrices. We do this thousands of times to see if the correlation between the two matrices happens by chance or not. This process is called permutation tests. At the end of tests, you get to know the chances of the observed correlation. If the chance is high, you don't have the evidence to conclude the correlation between the network of marriage ties and the network of business ties among the Florentine families. If the chance is low, it means the correlation is less likely to take place randomly. The two variables are less likely to be independent of each other. In other words, the two matrices are dependent on each other. This is the result of QAP correlation. How to interpret the results? The correlation between the network of marriage ties and the network of business ties is 0.372. This is the observed correlation. Does this correlation happen by chance? The results suggest that the chance is very low. How do we know? You look for significance. 0.001 means there is 0.1% of chance that the correlations between the two matrices are as large as the observed correlation after 5,000 permutations. If the significance value is less than 5%, we consider that the observed correlation is significant. Here, the significance value is 0.1%. We can reach the conclusion that the observed correlation is highly significant. Let's look at QAP regression. The difference between QAP correlation and QAP regression is that you need to specify which matrix is your independent variable and which matrix is your dependent variable. A dependent variable is your outcome variable. QAP regression allows us to see which variable is influencing the other. Let's use the same dataset of the Florentine families during the Renaissance to run QAP regression. We consider the marriage network as the independent network and the financial network as the outcome variable, that is, the dependent variable, based on the assumption that economic transactions are embedded in social relationships. To run QAP regression, you go to UCNet, Tools, Testing Hypothesis, Dyadic, and then select MR-QAP matrix, multiple regression via double-decker semi-partialing. You then load the dataset of business ties for the dependent variable and the dataset of marriage ties for the independent variable. This is the result of the QAP regression. How to interpret the results? R square value of 0.138 means that the network of marriage ties is not a major factor in the formation of financial ties among Florentine families. This regression model explains only 13.8% of the variation in the network of financial ties among the families. Still, the marriage network is significant. How do you know? The p-value is 0.0005. It means the marriage network is a significant factor. So the marriage network is at least one piece of the puzzle. And there are other factors influencing the formation of financial ties. Here is another example of QAP regression. On the left is a dataset that includes three node attributes, but I'm only interested in the attribute of gender. In the column of gender, 1 means female and 2 means male. The reason we use numerical data to code gender is because we'll need to convert the node attribute data to a matrix before running QAP regression. To convert the data, UCINet only recognizes numerical data. On the right is a network matrix. This is the dataset we've been using repeatedly in our class practices. 1 means a pair of nodes spent the most time together in the workshop. This network is our dependent variable. But to run QAP regression, we need our independent variable to be a matrix as well. How to convert node attribute data to a matrix? The approach we'll take is very similar to how we convert two mode networks to one mode networks. You can consider the column of gender as one mode and the people on the rows as another mode. We then use UCINet to convert attributes to matrix. For similarity metric, I choose exact matches. It is for categorical data such as gender and department. The result of this procedure is to create an outcome matrix called same gender. This is how we convert node attribute data to a matrix. The matrix on the right is called gender similarity matrix. 1 means a pair of nodes are in the same gender. Otherwise, it's 0. Now we are ready to run QAP regression. Our independent variable is the gender similarity matrix. Remember, here it's a similarity matrix. It's not the data about gender, but the gender similarity between the nodes. Our dependent variable is the interactions of people in the camp. We want to know whether the similarity in gender is a significant factor of people's interaction network. It is important that the two matrices are formatted with the same dimension and in the same order. For example, Holly is the first row in both matrices. If you put Holly in row 5 in our dependent variable matrix, UCNet will not allow you to run QAP regression. To run QAP regression, you go to UCINET, Tools, Testing Hypothesis, Dyadic, and then select MR-QAP matrix multiple regression via double-decker semi-partialing. Our dependent variable is the interaction network, and the independent variable is the gender similarity matrix. How to interpret the results of QAP regression? R square value of 0.10899 means the gender similarity is not a major factor in the formation of the interaction network. This regression model explains only 10.9% of the variation in the interaction network in the workshop. Still, the gender similarity is significant because the p-value is 0.0005. So the gender similarity is at least one piece of the puzzle, and there are other factors influencing the formation of the interaction network. In multiple regression QAP, the study of the dependence between matrices X and Y is compounded because there are other variables Z for which the association between X and Y must be controlled. For example, I assume the dependence between the gender similarity matrix and the interaction matrix is compounded because there is another variable of the row similarity. So to test the dependence between the gender similarity matrix and the interaction matrix, I need to control the row similarity. To do that, I need to first convert the attribute data of row to the row similarity matrix. I then load the row similarity matrix into UCINET as an independent variable, along with the gender similarity matrix as another independent variable. This is the output file of multiple regression QAP. R square value of 0.13709 suggests that the model explains 13.7% of the variance in the interaction network. After controlling the row similarity, the model now explains an additional 3% of the variance in the interaction network. The result of the p-value was less than 0.05, meaning the two independent variables of gender similarity and row similarity in this model are significant factors in determining whether a pair of nodes spent the most of their time together in the workshop. Still, there are 86.3% of the variance in the interaction network that cannot be explained by our model. We are obviously missing something important here. What other independent variables could explain how people interact in the workshop? To answer this question, you then go into the literature, develop more hypotheses, and test them.